Hi, hello everyone, and welcome to this webinar. I am Anis, the CEO and co-founder of Reolution. We are happy to host this first webinar. We have co-organized this event with companies, friend companies, Alibi, Ruslo, Advanced Biometrics, and 4M Biotech. Today, we will have the chance to hear five speakers from the industry talking about hydrogels and architecture of 3D bioprinted scaffolds for applications in tissue engineering. We'll now switch to Jakob. I just ask you, Jaron, if you can turn off your video just to optimize the quality of the talk and the quality of the broadcasting. So the next speaker is Jakob Lewicki from Alibi. And the title of his presentation is The Age of Alibi Applications, Strategies for Bioprinting Hydrogels. So Jakob, please.
Right, thanks for having me here. I'm very happy to give this presentation, especially that with, you know, without flying anywhere, I can reach a really great audience and listen to you guys as well. So that's right, I'm a customer success engineer at Alibi 3D Bioprinting Company, and I just mentioned my talk title, but kind of a sub theme that I wanted to talk about today is vasculature bioprinting. So very, you know, a specific application of 3D bioprinting using the hydrogels, some of that you already heard about today. So let's dig into the topic of bioprinting blood vessels. And I would like to start with a question: why actually we would like to introduce vasculature at the first place in our biomimetic constructs? And maybe the question and the answer is very obvious, but it's important to consider that there is a diffusion limitation of oxygen in tissue as well as in vitro situation, which is around 200 microns. And when we find cells being further away than that in a tissue or in a construct, they usually die due to hypoxia and cell death. So it's important to introduce some kind of channels or vasculature, especially if we want to introduce that construct later to a patient or to an in vivo model, but also for a big in vitro constructs. And there's been a number of different ways how to introduce vasculature. Traditionally, these techniques were based on self-assembly properties of endothelial cells, but with bioprinting, you really have this precision control, spatial control of where you want to introduce your cells, what is going to be the geometry of your scaffold. So that's where bioprinting can help with. So today I present you a few materials and strategies how to print these channels, as well as a few examples how our users are using these techniques to succeed in their work. And the whole theme of today is focus around different hydrogels. And of course, you will find very different and many different ways how to define and divide hydrogels. I like this one, especially for vasculature bioprinting, because we will talk a lot about sacrificial and matrix bindings. So more about the function of the ink, maybe rather than its origin. And I will very quickly go through a few popular choices for bioprinting vasculature. And the first one I want to highlight is one of my favorite ones that I worked quite a bit during my PhD, is sodium alginate, which is very simple polysaccharide that is derived from brown algae. Very easy ionic cross-linking mechanism, and has been shown to be really widely biocompatible with cells, always used in vitro, but also for in vivo delivery of different type of cells. Another one, collagen, that was already mentioned today, collagen type 1 especially, that is also present in natural ECM of blood vessels. It can, unlike alginate, it can support cell attachment with its cell attachment motifs. However, its gelation is a bit more tricky because it's temperature dependent. But I will present you some techniques how you can easily pattern this material as well for bioprinting and manufacturing blood vessels. The last one, or not the last one, but one of the last that I wanted to mention is gelatin, that we already heard about today quite a lot, so I'm not going to go into detail. Just another aspect of gelatin that I wanted to highlight is that this material can be also used for sacrificial or supported bioprinting. And I'll present one technique called FRESH that can be especially useful here, that is using gelatin to make a complex three-dimensional constructs, including blood vessels as well. And the last one, example of synthetic bio-ink, is called Pluronic 127, which is, as I said, synthetic copolymer. It has a feature of temperature depending gelation. So at room temperature, it will be a gel, but we can liquefy it again in 4 Celsius degrees, which gives us opportunity for actually patterning some blood vessels. And how you can do that is through different set of techniques. The first one I wanted to mention is so-called sacrificial bioprinting. So in this strategy, you can pattern a negative space of different channels, vasculature-like networks, using some sacrificial materials, for example, pluronic that I just mentioned, or carbohydrate glass. And later you can cast or also bioprint hydrogel around this structure and evacuate the sacrificial ink from your construct. And in this setup, you could have, for example, cells in the matrix bioink surrounding the channel, but you could also flash this channel with cells, coating them from the inside, creating this co-culture, for example, of cells and vasculature-like networks. So that's one strategy using sacrificial bioprinting. Another one that I already mentioned that is absolutely fantastic and it's has a very wide range of applications, but it's especially useful in bioprinting blood vessels, is called FRESH, freeform reversible embedding of suspended hydrogels. So FRESH is basically printing a gel in a gel. One gel, our target gel, could be, for example, sodium alginate that I mentioned already, or collagen. So gels that usually have low viscosity, they're difficult to pattern, but with using the support bath made of gelatin microparticles, we can keep everything together, providing this physical support for the construct that we are printing, as well as providing some cross-linking means for the target hydrogel. For example, in sodium alginate case, we could use a calcium chloride in our support bath to cross-link everything. And after we are done with printing, we can heat up the whole system to 37 degrees, dissolving gelatin and having our bioprinted construct released from the mixture. And the last technique that I want to highlight is coaxial bioprinting, which is basically printing using special nozzle that can extrude two materials or more at the same time, creating this laminar flow of fluids. And in special arrangement of these nozzles, we were able to print, for example, hollow fibers, having a sacrificial material running inside and in the shell material having our hydrogel. So this way we could make a hollow tubes. And now we'll show you a few examples how our users and other researchers are using these techniques for bioprinting different vasculature-like networks. And the first one is coming from Shrike Zhang lab, and especially close to my heart because Shrike was my opponent during my PhD dissertation last year. And in this paper, he used sacrificial bioprinting to create this thrombosis on a chip model. Basically, they created this model and infusing it with a whole blood, creating a clot that you can see in this figure comparing on the figure C1 and 3. In C, you have bioprinted construct. In 3, you have actual tissue from a human showing blood and then the red blood cells in a vessel. They were able to start modeling thrombosis, fibrotic thrombi deposition, having co-culture of Huvex and fibroblasts. And through this simple mechanism, they were able to create this quite close to in vivo mimic of a thrombus. So one interesting application of sacrificial bioprinting. Another one is using coaxial bioprinting. So here researchers were able to create two vessels. One was having two open ends, was mimicking the blood vessel. The other one had only one end open. And in between these channels, they placed a breast tumor cells, and the whole chip was better mimicking pharmacokinetics of drug introduced to the system. So in this scenario, doxorubicin was introduced, and you can appreciate on the figure E that already 2D and 3D environment, they had different reaction, or cells had different reaction to drug introduced to the system. But when you add this complexity of having two channels, all of a sudden you see that cells survive much better in this environment, meaning that it's harder to kill cancer, which is closer to in vivo scenario. So with printing these channels, you can also mimic things like pharmacokinetics and a drug diffusion in a tissue. And last example I wanted to show is actually applying the FRESH technique. And this case scenario, it was printing a heart mimic. So you can see that using FRESH, you can more directly print vessels that could be perfused. And you can see that effect of perfusion on a figure C and E. So C being without channel, without perfusion, and E having myoblast placed in a collagen construct with media perfusion, showing much higher percentage of live cells. Also, if you look at the bottom panel, when the researcher just casted the gel or 3D printed it with FRESH technique, you can see that after implantation, they found much a higher degree of vascularization of this construct in a tissue. So again, showing us that bioprinting has this advantage of creating more in vivo-like environment, also introducing very fine channels going down to, as you can see here on this figure, down to even 8 microns, which was also by recruiting the cells from the host. And all of these techniques that I just described, they're possible to achieve on our Allevit platform. So we have several different bioprinters. You can check them out going to our website, and they all create this versatile ecosystem that you can basically print any shape that you want, and you are not restricted to any special materials. We have really open systems, so if your hydrogel can be basically squeezed out of the syringe, probably you'll be able to bioprint that on our machines. And on top of the hardware, we have also software that helps you to have more repeatable results, just saving all the parameters for the next prints, having this more automated process. And it's easy to use. So if you're new to bioprinting, that's a great way to start your journey. And if you will have any more questions, here's my email address. But I think also now we're going to have a couple of minutes, so I'll be happy to answer if you have any questions about 3D bioprinting in general or bioprinting blood vessels.
Great. Thank you, Jakob, for this great presentation. We have a couple of questions. First one from Rafael from UBC, and he's asking, how do you determine a vasculature pattern to maximize nutrient delivery? Do you see for using medical scan data with machine learning for vascular patterns?
There are different approaches, of course, and if you want to have something very simple, you could just design it yourself using any CAD-based software. And that's something that I usually do for simple in vitro chips. Also something very easy, and I think very robust, and the method that you have a lot of control with is actually writing your own G-code, so a code that the 3D printer can understand. Actually, I was giving some workshops about this, and you can find also some instructions on our website if you want to have a good control of like the position of channels, the branching, and so on. Having a small construct, you can do it, but of course there are some repositories online, for example, NIH 3D Print Exchange, when you can download medical data and models to create this vasculature, or having more mathematical models of creating this network structures.
Thanks. Another question for you, Jakob. The question says, sodium alginate, although biocompatible, is not very good for cell attachment. How do you address that when using this material for vasculature in scaffolds?
Yeah, sodium alginate is maybe not the best when it comes to cell attachment. It's great for encapsulating cells, so kind of creating this soft environment to basically keep cells physically inside of the gel. However, if you want to introduce some more relevant, you know, cell attachment sites, either you could just mix it with some other hydrogels, for example, gelatin, and then you could create this interpenetrating polymer network, having, you know, two polymers intertwined together, creating this more complex hydrogel. But also it's possible to actually chemically modify sodium alginate, for example, with click chemistry, introducing some short peptides, for example, RGD. There are also commercially available modified sodium alginates that you can purchase, and they offer already this, for example, ICFAP or RGD motifs in the scaffold for better cell attachment.
Great. Fan is asking, how was the blood biocompatibility of collagen or gelatin printed vasculature?
Yeah, in general, it's very good. We see close to 100% viable cells, and of course, it's also depends on you handling the cells. But our printers, they have really good environmental control. You can control the temperature of the print head. So the question that also was asked before about how easy is to, for example, print JELMA, right? We have a system that really allows for easier printing of these materials, and also providing better environment for the cells to survive the printing process. So these two materials, I would say they're very robust and provide really good viability of cells. It might depend, of course, on the cell type that you're using, and there are, of course, many different cell types you might use for bioprinting vasculature, from HUVEX, from iPS cells that you might differentiate into HUVEX, for example, fibroblasts, co-culture of cells. But in general, these bindings, they have very wide range of biocompatibility, so we observe really good results.
In your bioprinting techniques, do you have any control on the collagen fibers alignment?
Yeah, that's a good question. We actually have one extrusion nozzle that allows you to align collagen or cells in the collagen in more homogeneous way. So this works with some mechanical alignment of these cells. But I think for more that would be probably more macroscopic, you know, organization of the scaffold. But collagen could be also, you know, more oriented on the micro scale with some other techniques. But I would definitely recommend to check out our dedicated nozzle for printing collagen. It's especially good for example for creating thin layers. For example, it was used for creating a skin model when you can pattern collagen with cells inside and basically kind of smear it physically, introducing this alignment of cells. Yeah, I guess we have a short internet break. I'm not sure it's me or not, but if it's not me, then again, I would like to invite you to go to our website. And yeah, you can also find me on LinkedIn or just send me an email if you have any more questions.
Jakob?
Yeah.
Have you heard the last question from Kate?
No, sorry, I lost you for a sec.
Sorry, I will ask that last question. So how do you optimize hydrogels when printing and when parameters tend to change as the print continues? Would you suggest using smaller volumes?
Yeah, so that's something to keep in mind using especially a pneumatic-based system like ours, that depending on the volume, you might change slightly the parameters or the outcome of your bioprinting. My recommendation for that would be try to be consistent, load the syringe with the same volume. Usually you don't use that much for bioprinting scaffolds. It's really rarely above, you know, hundreds of microliters of material for small scaffolds. So you should be good for that. But of course, there is a range of different techniques. I have one publication on actually optimizing fresh printing technique using neural stoma cells. And in that, I use some quantification methods developed by Webb and Doyle that are centered on around parameter optimization index. So more quantitative way of basically taking measurements of your parameters that you use for bioprinting and the outcome, trying to, you know, having more educated decisions about the parameters that you're using and how they might change also over the period of cell culture, because always time is the next dimension, giving a fourth dimension to our three-dimensional bioprinting. So that's something to keep in mind as well.
Perfect. Great. Thank you so much, Jakob, for this great presentation.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.